Welcome to the International College of Dentists Chronicles of Outstanding Leaders in Dentistry. My name is Dushanka Kleinman, and today I have the pleasure of interviewing Dr. Robert James Gorlin, a visionary clinician, researcher, and academician. Dr. Gorlin is a board-certified oral pathologist and clinical geneticist. And he currently is the Regents Professor of Oral Pathology Emeritus at the University of Minnesota. Welcome, Dr. Gorlin.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure
Thank
to have you here. We're going to start our discussion at the beginning of your life, and I wanted to learn a little bit more about those early years. You were born on January 11th in 1923 in Hudson, New York. Why don't you tell me a little bit about your parents?
My mother disappeared when I was very, very young, so I had no memory of her. My father ran a little Army and Navy store, which was essentially a front for his other activity, which was smuggling booze and muskrat, which was a very valuable and heavily used fur during those years.
That's pretty impressive. Did you have any brothers or sisters?
None whatsoever. None that I know of.
So you were the only child.
The only child.
And you had a father who was very creative.
Yes, he was.
And tell me about aunts and uncles and sort of the family
situation. I lived
situation.
With my mother's sister. She apparently had been pretty much of a maiden aunt all her life, and in fact brought up my birth mother. I lived with her until I was about 11 years of age, at which time I think she was going into kidney failure. And I then either was going to be put in an orphan asylum or I was going to go with my father. And my father rapidly got married, and I was a mean little devil and went to live with my father and my stepmother in New Jersey.
And what was that like? I mean, that's
Well, I'm sure it was very difficult for them because here was a very nice lady who had never had children. And I think I was probably a rebellious, well, I wasn't quite teenager, but I think I was a pretty mean guy. It was difficult, probably, for both of us, but it matured into mutual respect, and it worked out very well.
Now, during those times is a time at which young people are exploring sports, they're doing a range of hobbies, sort of identifying who they are and what they want to be. What are some of the things you did as an adolescent?
Well, I think that it takes a little bit of an explanation because I don't think I was especially good at athletics. I was very, very skinny. I was able to climb a rose trellis. That's how weightless I was. Most of my buddies were the kids of also gangsters. One of them I remember very well was a fellow named Bill Kaufman, who wound up in his later life selling time for NBC. But at that time, he had about three brothers, and I have no idea whatever happened to his father. The rumor was that he was killed by the feds in Atlantic Highlands Harbor. and his mother, Babe, normally carried a shoulder holster. And I remember climbing up a rose trellis onto his mildly inclined roof and then crawled through the window, and I must have disturbed Babe, who had a shoulder holster on one of those carved pineapples on the corner of her bed and scared me half to death. I then went in and woke up Bill, and we went out into the woods and made, Frankfurters or something along that line. As a child, I came from a family that really had not had any ambition as far as higher education. I think my father had possibly in sixth grade education. I don't have any idea how many years my mother had gone to school. My stepmother wanted me to be a priest because her brother was a priest. He had a small parish up in the Catskills. I think Catskills or possibly Adirondacks. The parish was all of about 30 people because they felt he could do little harm because he was a drunk. And I didn't think much of that idea. And my father wanted me to be a businessman. So in fact, when I went to school, high school, one could have several choices. And I chose commercial because I thought I was going to be a businessman. And when I went from this little town of Atlantic Highlands to Newark, it was an entirely different milieu. Virtually all the women, no matter how smart they were, would get married immediately upon graduation in this little town, and the fellas would hang around the garage. I don't think any of them went on to college. In Newark, it was 70% Jewish, upwardly bound. At least the 70% considered going on to college. So in mid-high school, I switched to pre-college, which was, I think, a little embarrassing to me because I was as tall as I am now, taking courses with 13-year-old children.
So when you switched,
I had to
pick up
those
things. You have to start again? Or did you have to take a different track?
I took a different track, and I took many of the courses that the freshman pre-college students had to take.
And you made that decision?
I made that decision because I went back to my folks and I said that I did not want to be in business. And the teacher said that if I did very well in high school, then perhaps I'd get a scholarship to go to college. And they said, well, you know, we have no money. And I was very lucky. I had some wonderful teachers in high school, and they gave me support. And I was lucky enough to get a scholarship to Columbia. I remember I applied to several other schools, all of which I got in, but I had no money to either for tuition or, in fact, to even visit them.
Well, and that was moving into even a bigger city from the cities that you had lived in. So what was it like going to Columbia College?
Well, to Columbia College, I migrated every day. It was about a two-hour commute from Newark by bus, by subway, by train. And it was clearly haves and have-nots. I don't know how it is now, but I suspect it probably hasn't changed that much. A large number of my classmates had actually gone to private school and had read most of the humanities and were quite aware of the contemporary civilization that all students at Columbia had to perforce take. That was the nature of the curriculum.
Yeah, it was like a great books curriculum.
It was like a great books curriculum, mm-hmm. Very similar to the Johns Hopkins
University of Chicago.
Yeah, University of Chicago. And I think that was wonderful. It truly changed my life. I had not read anything in high school.
Now, did you have a specific major, or did you open it up to a full liberal arts?
Well, everybody at Columbia had to have the 2 years, and I think I was a chemistry major. the fact that I was a chemistry major, I think, somehow caused me to try to prove myself when I got out, because I took a master's in physical organic kinetics, not one whit of which I have ever used or even thought about. I did that at Iowa. So I must have been trying to prove something to myself.
We were burrowing into a very difficult area.
I was, but I really enjoyed mathematics, and a lot of it is differential equations and reaction rates. It was a very pleasant 2 years, and I knew that I was going to have to go and put in my 2 years of service, this time under the doctor's draft. I had...
And that was right after you finished?
That was the Korean War. I had been in the Second World War down at Texas A&M. Mm-hmm. When I was at Columbia, I decided that I had taken enough. These were very unsettling years. I felt that by enlisting, I was going to get something better. Whether I really did or not, I'll never know. But it was very pleasant. They sent me down to Texas A&M, mm-hmm. and where I helped in part instruct. And then there was such a shortage in the year 1900, and I would guess about 44.
That's that, right before
People were so heavily involved, or maybe it was 43. People were so heavily involved in getting into the services that there was a national shortage of people applying to medical school, vet school, and dent school. And the sergeant called me out and he said, hey, any of you guys ever have anything called zoology? And a few of us raised our hands. Yeah. And he says, okay, I'm going to only tell you guys once. He had one of these dentalized T's.
Yeah.
And he says, you're going to line up. So we lined up, and he said, med, dent, vet.
No.
Med, dent, vet.
This is really what happened.
I was second in line. And my class had really a remarkable melange of people. One of my classmates was chief microbiologist for the state of Oregon.
Now tell me where you went.
Washington U in St. Louis.
Yes. And now, how did you choose that?
I didn't. I was assigned that.
And that's when they went through that lineup.
Assigned us the school, right. I don't think, truly, I'd ever heard of Washington U. I was pretty naive, and it was an excellent school. I think a lot of things are determined by chance. And that certainly was a very lucky bit of chance.
You were telling me about one of your classmates.
Yeah, there was another classmate that I had that was, I think he owned some drug stores in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. So a lot of my classmates were a wee bit older and had actually had a career. And I don't know what their backgrounds were, where they came from, but we all pretty much flourished. And dental school, medical school, and I guess vet school were probably all 3 years at that time rather than our now 4 years. Or I think it's in some schools beginning to enlarge even from 4 years. I know in Minnesota, they're starting for the first time anatomy during the summer, so it's even larger than 4 years. But it worked out very well, and I had no regrets whatsoever. I don't think as a child, had anybody asked me, I would have said, oh, I'm interested in medicine or dentistry or anything else. I didn't know what I wanted.
So it was sort of serendipity all the way
through. It was serendipity, and serendipity favors the prepared mind. And
that's right. I love that quote.
Yeah, and that's pretty much what it was. I was prepared.
Now, at each turn, mm-hmm. I mean, now we're looking at what you did in high school.
Yes.
You switched from one track to the other. Mm-hmm. Columbia.
Yeah.
You sort of jumped right into the Army after Columbia to
yes.
do your part.
Mm-hmm.
The chance turning of events
right.
in terms of recruitment. What chance happened during dental school?
I think the biggest influence during dental school was a teacher I had named Barney Levy. Barney was really beginning his teaching career. Consequently, he's not that much older than I, and I still keep in contact with him. Barney was teaching, I think, microbiology as well as the rudiments of pathology. You have to remember that many of the things, many of the basic sciences in dental school at that time were a little bit inchoate. They were just sort of emerging from the morass of teaching of basic sciences. The Guy's Report, which followed 10 years after the Flexner Report, was something that had a profound impact on dentistry.
Did you know Guy's?
I knew Guy's.
Yeah, the reason he's a chemist.
Yes.
That's what I was thinking.
Yes,
you were a Columbia.
I knew Guy's, but I knew him in his older years. Uh-huh. I never knew him when I went to college, of course. I never heard of Guy's. Certainly wasn't thinking about dental schools. But you have to remember the Columbia University Dental School was founded by the University of Minnesota. When the mandate it was just as Flexner had done for medicine, Guy's did for dentistry, and he said that the purpose of these organizations was to say that proprietary medicine and proprietary dentistry should cease to exist, and that all medical schools, all dental schools, should in fact be tied in with the universities. Mm-hmm. The last one that acceded to this, to the best of my memory, was P&S. And that was, I think, in the 1950s, so it really took a very long time. And the first effort toward the reunification of clinical and basic science, or the basic techniques of dentistry, really occurred at that sort of triumvirate of schools, the University of Illinois, Northwestern, and Loyola. Back in the 1940s, they brought a fellow named Kronfeld over from the University of Vienna. Vienna seemed to be the center for education, because at that time, and probably up until relatively recent times, dentistry was a branch of medicine. And so I think the powers that be, mostly at Northwestern, G.V. Black, and a number of those individuals, felt that it might be a good idea if there was a liaison established between the two centers, and over came Kronfeld. And Kronfeld did extremely well in establishing the basic science of dentistry. He wrote a very influential book. Then he perceived in himself some sort of neurologic problem, and he committed suicide. But right thereafter, and in fact during his lifetime, we had a lot of people coming from the University of Vienna. We had Joseph Peter Weinmann, who was not a dentist, he was a physician, who was a pathologist, and he did some oral surgery, and he was the one that diagnosed Freud's oral cancer. And then in order to escape the Holocaust, Peter came to the University of Illinois, and Freud went to London, where he died of his mouth cancer. Also coming over were Orban.
Yes.
And
still have that textbook on my shelf.
That's right. That's right. And Zicker, Harry Zicker.
Yes.
And another fellow who never really truly adjusted, and that was Gottlieb. Gottlieb went down to Texas, and I think he felt as if he were an island in a sea that really never accepted him. And he was also geographically separated, so I think that also made for a certain amount of depression.
Well, I think you're describing an incredible time at which the 40s and 50s, the migration across the ocean, And sort of the restructuring of dentistry as a profession, obviously the Guy's Report was a critical mm-hmm. document, which I think we still have many things to implement off
Absolutely.
Of it.
Absolutely.
But benefiting from what Europe predominantly had
yes.
developed, we're now in that process of internationally learning from one another again in dental education. Mm-hmm. We'll get back to those issues
sure.
a little bit later.
Well, there were issues, Dushinka, that we sort of look back on and chuckle about. Because when there was a Columbia dental school, mm-hmm. and I think it was located downtown New York. And when this Guy's Report came along, they wanted to establish a Columbia University dental school. And the way this was done is they asked a fellow named Alfred Oury from Minnesota, and he brought his young faculty. Now, he must have been a remarkable fella. He used to get his faculty up at 5 o'clock to go bird watching on River Road. And I don't think that went over too well with a number of people. But Alfred Oury had this thing that really brought him down. And that was, he believed there should be a group of individuals who clean teeth. This was considered anathema. And it was labeled by the local politicians as two-level dentistry. Mm-hmm. And in truth, he was squeezed out of Minnesota. He brought his young faculty with him. I think there were about 20 in number, many of whom still were extant at the time I joined Columbia in 1947. Mm-hmm. So, and Alfred Oury, when he got to Columbia, advocated two-level dentistry again. And he was asked to leave at Columbia, and he went, I think, to Connecticut, where he died. But you have to realize that dental hygiene really was delayed in its development until really the 1940s because of the general feeling that there shouldn't be two classes of individuals. And I think behind the feeling was economics.
Well, economics tends to drive a lot of discussions in terms.
It does.
I wanted to take a look when you went back to Columbia.
Yes.
Why did you choose pathology?
Well, when I was in dental school, I seemed to have a natural affinity for the basic sciences, and in large part, I think it was Barney Levy.
Mm.
Barney Levy talked to one of my classmates, and we both talked about the possibility of doing something after dental school. And he looked in magazines, newspapers, and he noted that both the University of Rochester and Columbia were offering fellowships. And they were not exactly generous in their funding. I think one offered $1,800 and the other offered $1,900 a year.
But we have to measure that in constant dollars.
Of course. You could probably have gotten an automobile for about $1,000.
Okay, that's a good way
to look at it. And I actually chose the $1,900 simply because it was $100 more. And they also said that what we could do was to take any chair we wished in the clinic, take a couple of hospital screens and screen off an area and make it our very own office. And they said, oh, I'm sure you can have private patients there. Well, the private patients turned out to be medical students and actors. So I actually had Marlon Brando and his roommate.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah, and his roommate, Wally Cox.
Any unusual characteristics or symptoms we should be aware of?
Well, these two guys were living in a four-floor walk-up in Hell's Kitchen when I first knew them. Wally didn't have a job. He and Marlon had just come in on a motorcycle. Mm-hmm. Yeah, on a motorcycle from Evanston, Illinois, where Marlon's papa was an insurance agent. And Wally, to the best of my memory, had a mama who was schizzy. Now, this is interesting because his first wife was schizoid. And I remember going to a picnic with her, and it was quite obvious to me she was schizoid. I think that Brando was pretty much a dour fellow at the time. He had a mother, however, who was into amateur acting, and maybe that's where he got his start.
But he had oral problems.
Well, he had little, they both wanted some free dentistry.
So that's how
I got into it.
But those fellowships were from the NIH.
One was one was from the NIH, and one was from, I think I might have been the first person to ever be a fellow of the NIH.
And I think maybe one of the first from the National Institute of Dental Research
I think I was, yes.
Did you have a chance to meet some of the people from NIDR at that time?
No, I did not.
It was
in the 40s. Yeah, I was pretty much on my own. It was a rather odd situation because my boss at Columbia had some sort of retroperitoneal sarcoma and frankly was dying. Mm-hmm. And so he gave me laissez-faire to take whatever I wanted, which was in a sense a blessing because it was a picnic. I sampled from internal medicine, from dermatology, from dermatopathology, and it really was dermatopathology that changed my life.
And you had really then begun the exploring across the disciplines during your residency then.
Yes, which was it was difficult at Columbia. Because I think that even to this day, there was not that degree of cooperation that I experienced at Minnesota. I remember that such areas as derm path, med path, surge path, pediatric path were totally separate one from the other.
They didn't benefit from each other.
No, and you couldn't go to another area. You'd be challenged. Mm. What are you doing here? And I think that's true in general in the Ivy League. Just turf.
Turf areas.
Yeah.
Well, you were 27 years old when you served as the oral pathologist at the Bronx Veterans Administration Hospital. And oral pathology even today is a small specialty. Tell me what it was like at that time.
Well, at that time I was really training. And Arthur Allen was the pathologist for the Bronx VA, and they had a very fine neuropathologist. I spent about half my time wiring jaws up there. There was a lot of trauma, and I learned a lot of oral surgery. Now, most of the appliances were extraoral appliances, and so it was really sort of 2 years of informal oral surgery training, and about one quarter of the time, maybe, I went over with Arthur Allen and learned a lot about sophisticated surgical pathology. So it stood me in good stead.
Well, I think each of these experiences, as you go in and there's a title, whether it's dental school or an oral pathology or a residency, you have been successful in exploring the depths of the opportunities within those settings. Before you were recruited to the University of Minnesota, you spent time in Greenland, University of Iowa, and concurrently served in the U.S. Naval Reserve at Great Lakes. Mm-hmm. Why don't you tell us a little bit about those experiences?
Sure. After about 3 years as an unofficial resident or fellow in oral pathology, if there was such, actually, I was in no way differentiated from the rest of the surgical pathologists. Okay. I could see no future because the Council on Dental Education of the American Dental Association did not require that oral pathology be taught in dental schools. The course that I received when I was a dental student was roughly 6 hours. We had a couple of hours devoted to dental decay and its complications, a couple devoted to, quote, pyorrhea, as it was then known, and its complications, one to strange teeth and one to everything else at a very low level. And I was really trying to establish the general area of what I considered the sort of biological basis for mouth disease. And I put up with this for about 3 years, and I really, not seeing a future for this, decided that, well, perhaps I ought to go to the dean. Because my experience in dating, for example, was to, because I had no money, take a lady out for a walk in Riverside Park. And one can do this just so many times before she says, Bob, would you like to go home and have a decent meal? And I knew that if I went home, they would put me on the carpet and they would say, now, what is it you do? And I'd say, well, I'm a dentist. Well, isn't that nice? Now, where's your office? Well, I don't have an office. Oh, well, where do you intend to have an office? Well, I don't intend to have an office. Now, where are you going to practice then? Oh, I'd like to create a field. And they would surely say to their daughter, this guy's a loser. Get rid of this guy as fast as possible. And I experienced about maybe 5 episodes of this.
And but you persevered.
I persevered, and I finally went to the dean, and I said, Dean, I just can't go on anymore. I have saved not one nickel. In fact, I'm deeply in debt. And if you hear of any job, let me know. And he said, in fact, I heard from somebody that wanted as few people to do as many jobs as possible. And he said, you do speak some Scandinavian language, don't you? And I said, yes, I do. And I said, who called you? And he said, I don't know. And I said, well, if you find out, give me a buzz. A whole month went by, and he'd forgotten about it, and I'd forgotten about it. And all of a sudden, he called me, gave me some sort of paper that had some sort of certification that I was who I said I was. And I took the A train down, and I got off at 150 Broadway, and I went up to the 10th floor, and there was Army, Navy, Air Force brass. And I couldn't understand what they were doing, but some fella said, well, can you do this, this, and this? Can you set up a lab? Can you open a dental office, you know, et cetera. So I said, well, yeah, I can do that. He said, oh, you'll be interested in talking to our medical director. And I said, where is he? Well, he's out of town. And I said, well, when is he coming back? Oh, no, we'll send you to meet him. And I said, well, how do I do that? And the fellow says, well, how do you feel about going MATS? And I said, I'm sorry, I don't know what you're talking about. He says, military air transport system. And I said, well, where am I going? And he says, well, we'll take you to Minneapolis. And I said, well, how about Monday? This was Friday.
Yeah.
And I said, is there any other way to get to Minneapolis? Oh, Northwest Airlines. I said,
I'll take that.
That's the one I'll take. So off I go. And when I was met, two guys who were dressed without anything special on them to indicate who they were. They asked for my identification once I was paged to go to the Northwest ticket counter. And I said to the guys, are we going? Well, we're waiting for your luggage. I said, I don't have any luggage. I just have overnight. And the guy said, well, we don't know. Get in the car. So I get in the car, and they showed me reasons why they had to know who I was, so I showed them my identification. And we traveled for about 45 minutes, and I kept saying to them, where are we going? And they said, south. And I can see we're going south. Well, we went about three-quarters of an hour, and then we turned into a bunch of little roads. And there were a bunch of World War II temporaries, which is now where we store old student x-rays and student records from the University of Minnesota. But at that time, it was federal land. And later, the the government gave it to the University of Minnesota. But before that, during the Second World War, it had been used by the DuPont Company to manufacture explosives mm-hmm. of some sort, experimental.
You were very trusting to take this journey.
Well, no, I met the following day, I met the medical director, and I tried to find out where this was going to be, but he wouldn't tell me until I signed up. And then I said that I was going to take my boards, specialty boards at the AFIP, and they said, oh, we can fly you mats.
Again.
Yeah. So, in fact, I did. I went mats, and I went to Annapolis. And then I came into Washington, took my boards, told my folks that I was going overseas. And actually, when I came back to Rosemount, Minnesota, 40 miles south mm-hmm. of Minneapolis, I was the point man for the university. We had 12,500 constructioneers, and we were doing the DEW line, distant early warning line, which was a system which was established to give the United States and Canada 35 minutes of advanced warning were Russia to fly over the North Pole. And while we were building the bases, Alert, Icebox, Nord, and Thule, intercontinental ballistic missiles were invented, making the whole thing silly. Mm. So we had orders then to rip three of the bases down and leave Thule. And Thule has gotten very good reports recently because many of the European airlines are now doing the true polar route.
Yeah, they are.
And right, and this gives us an opportunity, if they have trouble, to land at this first-rate base. So I lived in Thule for about a year.
So Operation Blue Jay
is
what it was called.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, that's an exciting
escapade. It wasn't terribly exciting when you were doing it. When I was a point man, I knew one of the problems would be the depression that we didn't call it seasonal affective mm-hmm. disorder, but that was essentially what it was. And I came in and I talked to some of the physiologists at the University of Minnesota, and they talked about light rooms. And
right.
So, in fact, we had light rooms. But this became somewhat extraneous because the minute anybody became a pain in the tush, we
sent
him out the next day. And since they were getting paid time and a half, we had a 48-hour week at the time, they thought twice about being naughty. But we noticed this enervation in ourselves, mm-hmm. and we noted the sort of paranoia in the dark, when it was dark all the time, and just the opposite, of course, when it was light.
Right.
And I'd signed up for a second year on a vacation. I went down to Panama, was naughty, ate some oysters and clams that I shouldn't have, and came down with hepatitis A. Mm.
I know you like oysters.
Yeah, I do. And I was released at Westover Air Force Base.
Okay. Well, at University of Minnesota, you've had a lot of connections to University of Minnesota.
I did.
You look at this issue back to the Guy's report and
yes.
its role in terms
yes.
of establishing the dental school at Columbia, and then, of course, this military experience and excursion.
Yes.
You chaired the Division of Oral Pathology at the
yes.
University of Minnesota and then the Department of Oral Pathology and Genetics.
Yes.
From 1956 to 1988, over
yes.
a 30-year period. Can you reflect on these years and sort of give us the major highlights that you see?
Well, I came in really on trust. And that was due to the fact that I had made connections. Bill Crawford, who was the dean of the dental school, and Harold Deal, who was the dean of the medical school, had spent many hours with me while I was trying to solve the problem of getting these constructioneers in reasonable shape. And they cooperated to the degree that their younger faculty agreed to keep their private practices open till about 10:30 in the evening in order to accommodate me. Because we had a limited amount of medical and dental resources up in northern Greenland, and we didn't even, in fact, have bases at this point. They were in construction, so we wanted them in at least reasonable shape. So I came in. Crawford was a fellow who, at this point, had not yet come down with his collagen disease, but he surely had dermatomyositis in retrospect. And steroids, of course, had not been used, right? And when they were developed by Philip Hench and his henchmen down at the Mayo Clinic. And so Crawford became one of the first patients. Mm. And because the doses were really not known terribly well during those years, Crawford became a bit paranoid. And he was having great trouble with his faculty. And I remember a caveat issued to me by one of the faculty to the effect that if he were to pick on me, I should indicate that I was going to leave. It was a remarkable experience. But the reason it was remarkable for me is because while I was a graduate student at Columbia, I had come into contact with the individual that probably had more influence on my life than anybody else. And this was absolutely a chance occurrence, because I decided that dermatology was going to help me, mm-hmm. That dermatopathology would help me even more. And at this time, there were a lot of individuals who were refugees from Europe, who had come over in part because of the Holocaust.
Right.
And the individual that truly made a great effect upon me was a woman by the name of Helen Kurth. Helen was prescient. Helen had the ability to understand things which are only recently being understood. She had the concept of growth factors.
She was a dermatologist?
She was a dermatologist. She was, in fact, escaping the Holocaust, although she was escaping before the Holocaust occurred. While she was Jewish, her husband Willie was not, and Willie went on to become head syphilologist of the city of New York until syphilology sort of ceased to be with the widespread use of penicillin.
Penicillin, right.
But Helen gave a lecture, and the lecture was, to me, almost a religious experience. It was an apotheosis. Helen talked about the relationship between gastric cancer and little lumps around the mouth, underneath the breasts, in the armpits, in intercrural areas, mm-hmm. and its association with gastric cancer. And I remember that this made such an impression on me that signs and symptoms around the mouth could be associated with something internal. And I went up to Dr. Kurth after the talk and I said, Dr. Kurth, what do you call these conditions where there are bizarre associations? Ach, she says, we call these syndromes.
And I said,
syndromes. And I said, what is that? Well, zin means together, and drom, I forget. Why don't you go look that up? So there was a little dictionary outside on the secretary's desk, and I looked, and I walked back in the room, and I said, Dr. Kurth means run together. And I said, are there other syndromes? Because I'm a dentist. A dentist? What are you doing here? And so I had to explain the idea that I was trying to create the field of oral pathology. And she thought this was rather interesting, and we really maintained some sort of contact up to the day she died. Because after all, if it weren't for her general infection of mm-hmm. my mind with the idea of syndromes, because again, when I got to Minnesota, during the very early years, I was in search of syndromes. I don't think I ever articulated that before, but I obviously was so influenced by that experience that I did. And when a woman telephoned me, because a friend of mine wanted to take a vacation in Europe and asked me if I would mind his office on Saturdays, I went down. And this woman, we'll call Muriel, mm-hmm. called me and wanted me to look at her cysts. And I said, well, what do you mean by cysts? Well, I have them in my jaws. And I said, well, how many do you have, one or two? Oh, no, I've had 50. And I said, 50? I said, you're not exaggerating. You really have had 50? Oh, yes, she says. And she says, I don't think you'd know who took them out. Actually, it was my boss at Columbia who had come from
traveled back and forth.
Gone to Columbia.
A
and
well-beaten
he was the,
path.
He was the fella. Yeah, he was the fella who had the retroperitoneal sarcoma. Mm-hmm. And so I got interested, and I saw Muriel for the first time the following week. Muriel walked in, and Muriel was a little kyphotic, and Muriel had a head which was much too large, but it clearly wasn't hydrocephalic. And she had a prosthetic left eye. And I noted a number of lesions scattered about her face. It looked to me like basal cell cancers. And I said, after a while, I said, now these cysts, I've looked at them at the U, because that's where they were all sent. And I said, but I'm more concerned about what's on your face. And she said, what do you think that is? And I said, I think these are basal cell cancers. And she says, well, cancer, that's pretty bad, isn't it? I said, well, yeah, it's bad, but you've obviously had these for a long time. And I said, I have a friend, Bob Goltz, who is a resident, I guess, or intern, or whatever he was at that time, in Durham, and he'll take off a couple of these for you and see if that's what it is. So she said, well, I have to talk with my brother-in-law. And my brother-in-law turns out to be a guy working on mucopolysaccharides in the University of Chicago.
Who was
and
that?
So, I don't remember his name, but his it'll come out in the end what the story was. It was her sister's husband. Mm-hmm. And the fella, when I explained to him that Muriel looked a little unusual, he said, you know, she has an awful lot of records. And I said, well, I'd heard she did. And so I got a x-ray of her skull. She must have had 100 x-rays of her skull. We didn't have panorexes, but I had oodles of jaw cysts. She really did have 50. And Muriel had some pain in her belly when she was 14 or 15. So she had a lot of flat plates. And of course, this is the TB era, so she had a lot of chest films. And I noted that Muriel had calcification, which was lamellar, layered, in the front part of her brain. I didn't know that this was seen in normal people. And I noted Muriel had a number of bifid ribs, and I didn't know whether this was found in normal people. Now, Muriel in her belly had bilateral calcifying, as it turns out, ovarian fibromas. And the reason why Muriel was having problems before was because they were twisting on their pedicle, because they're pretty heavy, and giving her owies. Well, I took the whole mess of films, and I went over to radiology, and I had a lot of friends over there, and I said, well, now, what about these calcifications up here? Oh, this is a calcified Falks. Well, do you ever find this in the normal population? They said, oh, yeah, but it's rare. It's, maybe a couple of percent. And I said, well, what about the bifid ribs? Well, maybe one in a couple of hundred. I said, yeah, but what about the stuff in the belly? Well, you don't find that in the normal population. So I said, well, this all comes from the same lady. And I said, I don't know, maybe it's a syndrome. So I came back and I started looking through the literature. And the first literature you start looking through is French and German literature, because they've all been described before. Right. And I didn't really find anything. I found something maybe in the early 1900s, 1905, related to inherited basal cell carcinomas. Muriel was a maiden lady, and she never had any children. So I knew nothing about the inheritance pattern at that point. Then Herb Lund, who was at the AFIP and the head of dermatopathology, put out a fascicle. And he had a picture in there of a mother that looked just like Muriel and her daughter, and they had ovarian fibromas. And so I called up Herb and I said, yeah, it's fascinating. Do you know these people? No, he didn't know the people. And I said, well, I found a number of cases. And in fact, in 1898, I think this condition has been described in England before. So I gathered all the cases I could, and we published this in New England Journal of Medicine. And that's where the syndrome comes from. Muriel's brother-in-law, I think, died, but it turns out that Muriel had a sister whose cysts did not manifest themselves until she was 60 years old. And I never knew, to this day, known anybody whose first manifestation of cysts was at age 60. But Muriel did not know anything about her folks, obviously, if both she and her sister were involved. One of her parents must have been involved. But at that time, I did not meet them. I think they might have been dead. And so there was no family history, as far as I was concerned, at the time.
Well, this is a wonderful example of the detective work.
Oh,
and also not stopping at the head and neck, which is something that is done more often than not.
Sure.
But also persevering. I mean, carrying cases over the years. You have done that in many other situations where you have not only revisited, but also gone back to previous centuries.
Sure.
As you said, documentation has existed for a long time.
Sure.
I'd like to turn to your professional society activities. You've been a member of numerous and very diverse organizations, and an elected officer of, you know, serving as president of the American Academy of Oral Pathology, obviously of the International Association for Dental Research, Cancer Coordinators, the International Society of Craniofacial Biology, vice president of the Birth Defects and Clinical Genetics Society, and the board of directors on the American Society of Human Genetics. I'm not listing all of them.
Sure.
How would you describe your leadership style within these organizations? It's very important, has made a major impact.
I don't think, Dushinka, I ever had any style. I think I was probably a miserable administrator, because my biggest error was that I felt I could do things better if I did them myself, and that is wrong. The ABCs of being a good administrator is to allocate duties, and I was bad at that.
Well, but leadership style comes in all forms and shapes.
Right.
And taking the initiative to take something forward and initiate it, as you have done over and over again, takes a person to do that. And oftentimes when we go back to people not being able to initiate anything, it's just that individual person taking action. So you sort of paved the way for
others to follow. When I first got to Minnesota, well, many of these things sort of fall in place. When I first got to Minnesota, I wanted to have some impact, I think, on dentistry and medicine. And we talked to a fellow who was head of the American Cancer Society. And we all felt, from chatting with dermatology and dentistry, that maybe setting up a sort of lab exam, but not letting people know it was a lab exam, was one way to do it. And the head of the Cancer Society said that there was a town in western Minnesota called Wilmer that was about 4,800 in population. And we decided to have a mass mouth cancer exam free. Now, the trouble was we hadn't a clue as to how to go about doing this. None of us had any experience. There was no television, so we had to use radio. We talked to the Ministerial Association, we talked to the Rotary, we talked to the Grange, and we set a time aside in an armory. and we borrowed a lot of hospital screens and a lot of sterilizing solutions. And I think all of the dentists and all of the physicians in this little town, save one, cooperated. So we decided to go out and give them an 8-hour course in skin cancer and premalignant lesions of the skin and oral cancer and premalignant lesions of the mouth. And we didn't know whether anybody would show up. We tried to limit this to individuals over the age of 35. And we knew that the farmers were reaching that stage when they had to harvest their grain. And so we set hours of 4:30 in the morning when we were going to open up the armory. And when it came time, there were people actually lined up.
Before 4:30?
Before 4:30. And it became so successful after 16 of these sessions that Wangenstein, the famous surgeon, came to me and says, "Bob, I know you've had great success doing your mouth cancer stuff. Tell me how you went about it." And he said, "We want to do breast." And so that's where the National Breast Cancer thing came from. It was our mistakes that sort of led to this. And it was a lot of fun.
Well, but that's another wonderful example of bringing all the sectors of society together.
Yeah.
And making sure that it's an issue that is important to the community.
Yes.
And with the farm workers, you had a lot of
sun exposure. Yeah, thank
that
goodness
was for the dermatologic.
The blonde,
exam,
blue-eyed
right.
Scandinavians didn't settle in Texas. Well, we had about 3 cases per 1,000 of skin cancers.
Picking those up during the
same
time.
Yeah, and we had about maybe 1 case per 1,000 of squamous cell cancer of the mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And at least 3 premalignant leukoplakias.
Well, these are, they remind me, we are now revisiting that whole issue of screening and early diagnosis.
Yes.
But you added that dimension at that early stage of the dermatologic exam and the oral cancer exam. Oftentimes
right.
we go in and look at only one body part at a
right.
time. For the American Board of Medical Genetics, you were the founding member and the founding board of directors and founding member for the Foundation for Developmental Medical Genetics.
Yes.
And you saw the whole genetic revolution evolve.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about.
Well, I was surely at that time the only dentist, and I also represented a syndrome person.
And the syndrome carried you.
The syndrome,
from
yeah, the
Columbia
syndrome carried me into genetics.
Mm-hmm.
The early years, it consisted of a melange of people with very little common background. Dave Smith, who was certainly an extremely influential guy. And who, when I first knew him, was at Wisconsin, but who later went to Seattle and became one of the founders of clinical genetics. Victor McCusick. Victor was an internist who had come out of Boston, and he had been working with a fella named Harold Yeagers, who was actually his boss. And Harold Yeagers of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome was head of internal medicine at a very small school that I actually applied to, thinking I might possibly get a job. And this was in Jersey City, and it was a school with a very short history. It didn't last long. It was run by Mayor Haig, and I think it was connected to a hospital called the Mary Margaret Haig, and it was totally boss-controlled, and it went under dissolution very rapidly, and I think a lot of people formed the New Jersey School for Medicine and Dentistry from that group.
From that beginning.
But I remember talking to Yeagers. Yeagers was interviewing me for the job, and I said, Dr. Yeagers, do you have anything to do with Poitz Yeagers? Oh, yes, he says. I said, tell me how you discovered the syndrome. He says, actually, I didn't discover the syndrome. And I said, I don't mean Dr. Poitz. He was back in the 20s in the Netherlands. Now, how did you happen to come across a case? He said, I didn't. So I said, how did the paper get written? He said, you don't remember the paper. I said, you're right, I don't remember the paper. And he says, look and see who is the second author. McCusick. His resident.
Yeah, there you go.
And so that school rapidly was on the decline. I thought, no way do I want this. And I had made so many connections in Minnesota that I knew that Minnesota was for me. I had great connections, great cooperation. Crawford at this point was beginning to suffer a lot from his disease and his over-steroid
treatments,
yeah.
But you were a visionary in setting up the professional societies.
Well, I helped with the board.
Clinical genetics.
Yeah, the board was a remarkable group. There was a lawyer who was also a geneticist, and she got us incorporated. And she got us incorporated, to the best of my memory, in Texas, because I think that's where she was at the moment.
And the disciplines on the board that you
collected? Yes, there were a melange of people that represented all sorts of areas. Mm-hmm. And we decided, we were all appointed actually by the American Society of Human Genetics. Mm-hmm. And how they actually selected me, I don't know, but I represented syndromes because my first book on syndromes antedated the development of organized medical genetics. So I came in through the back door. And I also was pretty good at Bayesian probability. Mm. And I think those two factors entered into it.
Well, and that so was an exciting time.
It was a very exciting time because I think all of us learned that we didn't know how to make questions. We fortunately had a number of people who were professional at making questions, and they put it through a filter and took out all the ambiguity that we were not cognizant of at the time. But it was great.
What the question should be about.
Well, we
you knew what the focus was going to be.
Yeah, I think at that time there was a lot of focus on things which subsequently meant nothing, such as palm prints, footprints. We had areas of genetics that have long since disappeared. Even Bayesian has largely disappeared because Bayesian was conditional probability. And at that time, we knew so little that we would say, well, if. And then that was, of course, a different type of probability because that was Bayesian. Now, all we do is we say, it isn't what if. We know that.
And you're able to dissect it even more.
We're able to dissect it and now find the base and you know, what base has been substituted for what base. And
now, you have been recognized and received many, many honors and awards over your career and continue to. You have honorary doctorates from the University of Athens, Aristotle University, University of Maryland.
Yeah.
I could go on and on with many, many of the
University of
awards.
Minnesota.
You're
on the 16th
in the
of
16th.
May.
Coming up. Oh, congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. It's nice to be recognized by one's peers.
I think the peers recognition is probably one of the most important.
Right.
Tell me of your various awards and honors, which ones mean the most to you?
Well, I think that one that means a lot to me is the Anno Primaverdi. This is the Italian version of the Nobel Prize. They've given it in genetics to about maybe 13 people so far, and I was honored to be among them. It took place in Spoleto about 1995.
Place.
Weather was fantastic.
During the jazz festivals.
And I started my speech off in Italian.
You did? Yeah. What did you start?
Sono profondamente onorato nel ricevere questo premio. You know.
And wonderful.
On, and
wonderful.
On I went.
You're but a linguist.
No.
How many languages do you speak? Ham is
well,
good
I can
for language.
I can understand about seven.
And you can say quite a few words.
Oh well, yeah, that doesn't mean anything.
And you're a senior member of the National Academy of Sciences.
I am.
And the Institute of Medicine.
I am.
And that's a real distinct honor
it is,
as well.
It is. And I wish we could get more people from Minnesota or the Midwest. I do think there is a tendency, maybe they don't even recognize it, that the number from the East Coast and the West Coast vastly outnumber the individuals from the Midwest. In Minnesota, at the University of Minnesota, there's only Paul Quinn and I that have this distinction.
And you serve as mentors to
yes.
the people within the university and beyond.
I do.
And I think it is important mm-hmm. for that kind of distribution to be considered. You've had visiting lectureships and professorships mm-hmm. in countries all over the world. I'll just mm-hmm. name a few.
Sure.
Israel,
yes.
and Denmark,
yes.
Ireland,
yes.
Germany,
yes.
Italy,
yes.
Holland, England, Canada. What were those like? I mean, you got to meet people from
well,
everywhere and share with them.
The one that really sort of stands out was the one in the Netherlands. I occupied the Spinoza chair. Mm-hmm. And the stipulation there was that I give four major lectures, different lectures, obviously, in Amsterdam, but I have to give several in outlying territories, and they gave me a choice of where I should give them: Maastricht and Nijmegen and Groningen and Rotterdam, etc. So it was a lot of fun, and I gave talks on hereditary hearing loss and its syndromes, and more or less what I felt like giving in different areas.
Well, I know that they appreciated having you come, and I'm sure it catalyzed their energy and
well,
their
I maintain
research.
A lot of contacts, yeah, because I'm still heavily involved. In spite of the fact that I retired in '93, I still am
very active.
I'm still very active. There are a lot of syndromes that I left dangling in '93, and either had not described yet, but had met patients with a disorder that I felt would be nicely pursued to the base level, to the molecular level. And I think I've almost done all that.
Wow.
A lot of it is cooperation between and among people, because very often I'll telephone them and I'll say, can you give me a month? To do the molecular work. I'll do all the rest of the work and gather up and examine all these people.
And you're moving through that quickly. Let me just say that if we were to say that you're prolific in your writing, that would be a major understatement. Almost 600 articles,
yes.
books, and book chapters.
Mm-hmm.
And as I took a look at this volume of publication, which is so important to
yes.
disseminate your findings throughout mm-hmm. the world, I was very much enamored with a wide range of journals
mm-hmm.
that you published in, beyond the dental
yes.
Journals, the Journal of the National Cancer Institute way mm-hmm. in the beginning,
mm-hmm.
the Journal of Veterinary Research,
yes.
the Archives of Dermatology, your,
yes.
your catalytic
yes.
point. Pediatrics, the New England Journal of Medicine, Lancet most recently, the Archives of Ophthalmology, Journal of Psychiatry, Journal of Retinology,
yeah.
and the Journal of Medical Genetics, of course, are just a few of them. What's your secret?
I'm not sure I have any secret, but I do try to get the articles that I'm specifically interested in well-refereed journals. Mm-hmm. Perhaps the strangest paper I ever wrote was published in, I think, Journal of Colonic Disorders on the patron saint of hemorrhoids, Saint Fiaker.
There is a patron
there
saint.
There is a patron. Was a patron,
patron saint
for
everything.
For everything. Right. Right.
Oh.
And Saint Fiaker was also patron saint of gardeners. That's where the word fiacre comes from.
Fiacre, the car.
The cart, yeah.
There you
People
go.
Used to go to visit St. Fiacre and in fiacres.
I see. Yeah. Okay. That's good to know.
That's really useful for crosswords. For crosswords. Yeah.
Now, your first book was co-edited with Jens Pinborg, right?
Yes, was edited with Jens, yes.
Tell me about your relationship with Jens and the syndromes of the head and neck.
Well, Jens and I knew each other, I think, from meetings. And we had often talked, because at that point I was really into syndromes, and that was about all I was talking about at national meetings. And he and I said, well, maybe we ought to get together at some point and write a little monograph on syndromes. And he said, well, why don't you apply for a Guggenheim and a Fulbright? And I said, Jens, I can't do it because I haven't been in Minnesota that long. I had gotten to Minnesota in 1956, and this was around 59 that he approached me about this. But I applied, and I got them both. And I went to Copenhagen, and Jens got me a little home that I rented outside Copenhagen. And I utilized their library system, which I found very inhibitory because they would not let me in the stacks, and I really work well within stacks. And I think even to this day, you can't go in the stacks. You go up to the desk and you say, may I have three journals for the next 15 minutes? And they're very nice about it, but that's not the way I work. So after about 6 months, I happened to be down in Rome giving some paper at some international congress, and I saw Carl Witkop, and Carl said, I have to go up to Copenhagen and work for a couple of months. And I said, Carl, take my house. Here's the key. And
now, was Carl with you at that time?
No, Carl was not. Carl was not at that point. I think I was thinking of having Carl join me if he would. But at that point, Carl was still here at the National Institute of Dental Research and doing extremely well with his old primary work on pigment disorders. And I left early. I think I was in Copenhagen maybe 7 months.
But you finished the book. You finished the
collaboration. I went back to Minnesota and I finished the book because I could work much better in my own environment. And the book, I think, ran into maybe a few hundred pages and covered perhaps 100 syndromes. And it became obvious that we were just touching the surface. And so I took on another fellow who was interested in syndromes. And we put out the second edition in about 1976. And then he died really before the book came out. And in 1990, I put out the third edition. Third edition really began to become, at that point, the standard birth anomalies book used by medicine all over the world. And about 3 months ago, the fourth edition came out. It's about 1,300, 1,400 pages. It deals with about, oh, maybe 2,000 or more syndromes. Meanwhile, what had happened with regard to hearing loss, I used to go down annually for Victor's fellows. And I got to know a fellow named Konigsmark. And Bruce saw me one day, and he asked me if I would review an outline that he had for a book on deafness syndromes. Now, you have to remember, Victor was a very unusual guy. I remember when people, his fellows, came from anywhere, he said, genetics is not enough. He said, you're going to have a field. So he says to one lady, you're going to need eye. So he just sent her to train in eye.
So specializing in the different
components. And actually, Konigsmark was a pathologist who was really a neuropathologist, and came to Johns Hopkins a year early through some misunderstanding. And since he had this year to put in before he actually started his neural path, Victor tried to convince him that he should learn something about genetics and that he should learn something about, as he says, ear. So he did exactly what you or I would do, knowing nothing about the field. He got all the papers he possibly could, and he arranged them in piles. Hearing loss all by itself, which appears to be genetic, hearing loss with kidney disease, mm-hmm. hearing loss with neurologic disorders, hearing loss with eye, you know, et cetera. And I thought this was a rather nifty arrangement. And one day he said, Bob, he said, would you take a look at this? And I said, oh, you got a shoebox full of stuff there. And I said, I'm doing the second edition of Syndromes, the Head and Neck, and I really can't look at it for months. And he says, well, that may be a problem. And I said, okay, Bruce, I said, I'll tell you what. I will do my best. I could send you my stuff on hearing loss. And he said, no, I have to send you mine. And he sent it, and he died of chronic myelogenous. And I felt there was a moral obligation. So
and
I
you
put,
had a gift
I,
in
I
your lap.
Out, I put out the book. Mm-hmm. And then the book I have turned over now to Helga Torriello. Mm-hmm. And Helga is putting out the third edition.
So each of these has been almost like a, you've given birth to a series of evolutionary publications. I think if you look at each edition, the growth and also the specificity of the findings in each edition is
well, it's huge. The latest edition, the fourth edition, has about 4,500 pictures, which of course is necessary when you're dealing with syndromes. And we deal with maybe 2,000, 2,500 disorders. I do think that I made a terrible mistake in waiting 5 or 6 years to start the next edition. This book, which came out a few months ago, Syndromes of the Head and Neck, Edition 4, should be worked on right now for the fifth edition.
Yeah. Well, you almost are at a stage now where you need a virtual book.
Yeah.
Because the rapidity of finding new information is such that, you know, maybe through a supplement to the text before it becomes published could be a running.
Sure. We're going to put out a CD-ROM.
Oh, that's a good way of doing it.
And on the CD-ROM, we're combining it with the London database, mm-hmm. which is out of London, obviously. Mm-hmm. And we're also going to add a very large section showing syndromes at different stages, that is, in the newborn, in the child who's 3 and the child who's 9. Or
so they'll be almost like filming someone through their developmental
correct,
stage.
Correct, and we'll probably do this for about 100 syndromes. And my partner, to whom I'm actually turning over the book, is Raoul Hennekam from Amsterdam. And he's coming over and spending a part of August with us. And
very good.
I have 45,000 slides, and we're digitalizing
You're
these
getting,
for the yeah.
Getting totally organized. Well, I have here that you've been an incredible pathfinder and path creator. And for example, exploring and building the specialty of oral pathology. Mm-hmm. Directing and contributing to the evolution of clinical genetics, mm-hmm. melting the walls between dentistry and medicine, mm-hmm. and working at the interface of many medical specialties as well. Which of your characteristics or attributes do you feel contributed to your perseverance and these explorations?
I think my ability to get along with people. If it hadn't, I don't think I would have thrived. I definitely wouldn't have thrived in an Eastern school because my strength, what little I have, is in cooperating with people and getting along with people. I think I did much better in dentistry than I would have in medicine. People always have said, well, didn't you choose the wrong field? And no, I didn't choose the wrong field. The field chose me, and I couldn't have been in a better field because the dean really left me alone, and I was my own best driver.
What would you recommend to someone who's pondering a career in dentistry?
I find dentistry exciting. It's not the dentistry which existed when I was a child. It wasn't the purely mechanical aspects of dentistry, which again have become really quite sophisticated engineering problems. Right next to me, there are working approximately 50 people in dental materials, and it's certainly one of the better programs in this country. Many of these individuals are physicists or electronic engineers in addition to being dentists, and they've given new composition to dentistry, new outlooks. I think coming in with a different background is sometimes very salutary. It's not uncommon for a couple of our people to go into law after dental school or after medical school, and it is not rare for individuals with an engineering background to come into dentistry, and I think that's marvelous.
And that's very diverse. Let me just ask you a few questions about your family and your wonderful wife, Marilyn, and your two children.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about them.
Well, I was very lucky. It was a blind date. I was coming back. I was coming back from Greenland, going back to Greenland, and I had a very short period of time. And I went to see my buddies at Columbia, and it was truly blind date because the gal who ultimately recognized that my wife might be a good mate for me was. Unfortunately, in a position where she had never met her, and vice versa. And we met, and I think we went to a Westminster Kennel Club for our first date, and then we had a second date, which was a play on Broadway. And I think there were possibly two more dates, and I went back to Greenland. And as I said, I became ill with hepatitis A, came back, and essentially we had our courtship, if one can call it that, by her visiting me at the Bronx VA hospital.
so healthcare was a big part.
Right. I think that she was probably shocked when I took her to the Great Midwest because she was New York born and bred, and probably her idea of West was New Jersey.
And any dentist
became,
in the family?
Not a soul. She had no soul. She had nobody but manufacturers in her ladies' dresses, ladies' half sizes. In fact, her father created the first half-size house in the United States.
A very important aspect.
You bet, because there are a lot of people who do not have this ideal body build.
And your children?
Well, we were very fortunate. We were, I think, about 30 and 27 or 28 when we got married. And so within the first year, we had a little girl. And it was fairly obvious that because we were so politically active, that both kids really had a lot of exposure to garden variety politics, going to little meetings, passing out pamphlets for all sorts of things. And my wife became assistant head of the Democratic Party for the state of Minnesota.
That's
and broke
terrific.
With Johnson Humphrey over the war. And I led the talk in at the university, which was not a terribly popular issue at the time. And I led the march on the Capitol. And it was fortunately raining that day, so I didn't get hit by any bricks.
Oh, no, nothing in this wonderful town we're in right now.
Right.
Before we close, and this
yes.
has been a delightful time okay. having a chance to speak
Thank
with you.
You,
what are some things that you'd like to say to those that are following?
I think it's important if one has time to really do one's own thing, to not be inhibited by the stringencies placed on you by academia. I found that being on committees was, for the most part, worthless. I don't think I contributed terribly much on committees. I think that probably most committees could be dispensed with. I wish that I had a leadership ability in which people could make changes in a field by being a successful committee person, but I seem to possess none of those attributes. But we need good administrators. A school could not run without good administrators. There have been a few deans that I believe have been truly outstanding. One of the most remarkable was Isaac Schauer at the University of Illinois, right. Joe Volcker, ultimately University of Alabama. Mm-hmm. Irwin Schaefer, University of Minnesota, because Irwin gave me absolute laissez-faire to do exactly what I wanted to do. I think I could do pretty much what I wanted to do when Crawford was dean, because Crawford was ill, and he gave me support without actually supervising anything. I was my own best driver.
Well, I think what you're saying is we live in various communities, mm-hmm. and we can help each other in various ways.
Exactly.
You have been a major change agent, mm-hmm. for dentistry, for clinical genetics, for pathology overall, and as a role model for all of us that have had a chance to watch you from afar or up close.
Thank you.
And I wanted to thank you for all that you've done and all that you're about to do.
Yes,
because
yes.
Your work continues at this point at an incredible pace.
Yes.
And I wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you
thank
very
you.
Much.
Thank you.
Thank you.